We've learned a bit about character, we've learned a bit about structure, but now it's time to see how they intertwine. It's time to see how story structure is not just an external journey of going through some physical world, it's also an internal journey of a character arcing. And we're going to look at the beats of a character arc. We're also going to look at what needs to happen in your story in order to make your character arc more believable. So, story structure as character arc. We typically think of story structure in terms of an external journey. That's kind of like the hero's journey and other story paradigms. They teach it to us in kind of this hero going through a new world physically, right? But it's more than that. It's also an internal journey of a character going through a change of their belief system. And we can fit a character's arc right on top of that traditional three-act structure. And we're going to look at how we might do that. If you're not familiar with story structure, be sure to watch one of the previous videos and you can see a basic intro to three-act structure and kind of how we go through the basics of a story. So remember that a character arc can generally be two different types. One is the positive arc, which is where a character goes from moral weakness to moral strength. In other words, they have some flaw, something that is negatively impacting their relationships, and by the end of the story, they have to learn their lesson and overcome that. Now, a negative arc is more like a corruption arc, where a character starts as either flawless or just neutral, you know, they're not doing anything in particular to harm their relationships, and then they end up becoming corrupted or tempted in some way, and they now have an immoral worldview or something that's negatively impacting their relationships. So that's a positive arc and a negative arc. And most stories are positive arcs. It's also worth noting that sometimes a character needs to resist change. So they might already have the correct way of living life. They might already be a good person, right? And then they've got to stand up in the face of a corrupt society or community. And that's kind of the case in Ratatouille, for example, where Remy already understands that everyone can cook, or, you know, rats can cook, right? And then he's got to stand up in front of others who tell him that only the select few can cook. So that's an important part of that arc, is resisting change. And it's also important to remember that sometimes characters don't arc in a story. A protagonist or a main character doesn't need to arc. And sometimes it's the community around them that arcs, which is the case in Paddington Bear, for instance, or Little Miss Sunshine. But this scenario is where the community arcs and not the character. That's beyond today's scope. We're not going to cover that. So how does the beginning of a character arc match with the beginning of story structure? Well, first, the audience needs to know the context in which the character change is going to take place. So we've got to provide that information to them up front. And if you aren't familiar with kind of the context around how a character changes, go check out the video on creating deep characters. And we talk a lot about what makes a character kind of deep and multidimensional. And one of those things is a character's emptiness or their void. And that emptiness is something within them that's missing that they're always trying to fill, sometimes in healthy ways, sometimes in unhealthy ways. And that emptiness can come from either a ghost event from the past, something traumatizing that's still affecting them to this day, or some sort of obsession that they're always trying to pursue and fulfill. And we'll go over a couple of examples of that. And it's also worth noting that a character can have coping mechanisms. And these coping mechanisms are behaviors that the character adopts in order to deal with their past pain. This is mainly a model that goes with a character who has a trauma from the past. And they will try to cope with that trauma in ways that are perhaps unhealthy and that give rise to moral weaknesses, which are behaviors that are negatively impacting their relationships. And we're going to look at a couple of examples of those as well. And then lastly, a character can have a belief about what will bring them happiness. And typically this belief is actually wrong. So the character might believe, I will be happy if I just win the approval of this person, or I will be happy when I get to this physical place. I will be happy when I get a promotion at my job, whatever it is. But they need to come to realize that their happiness typically comes from within. It comes from their own value and them being able to accept themselves, that kind of thing. So in the beginning of the story, we want to provide this context subtly to the audience through action so that they can understand the context around the character's change. We first have to see how the character is flawed in order to see how they will become flawless or unflawed or fix that flaw in their personality. And likewise, if you're doing a negative arc, make sure that we see how the character is not flawed so that we can see how they will become corrupted. So let's look at a couple of examples. In the beginning of Finding Nemo, we first see Marlin's ghost event, which is the Barracuda attack on his family, the thing that destroys his entire family except for Nemo. And that's the thing that really defines who he is. It's a traumatizing event, right? And so out of that comes a coping mechanism and a behavior, which is to a desire to prevent harm, which is understandable, right? But he takes this so far that it negatively impacts his relationships, and particularly his relationship with Nemo. He tries to control others. He has an inability to let go. He tries to control Nemo. And that is a moral weakness because it's a behavior that's negatively impacting the health of his relationships. Now let's look at the beginning of Toy Story. We start with Woody playing with Andy, and we see how he's the leader of the toy group. We see his obsession with being the top toy. Now he is selfish when his position as top toy is threatened. That's his moral weakness. He's got that selfishness about him. So we want to be sure that we convey that to the audience in the beginning of the story. What's the character's moral weakness? How are we showing it through action? If they have some event from the past, we may want to show that up front, or we may want to keep it hidden, like in Casablanca, and show it a little later. So there are a lot of options we have as far as that's concerned. So the next step in this structure that also takes into account character arc is the inciting incident. This is the event that's going to force the character into action. And we talk about this in structure paradigms as being where the character gets sent into a new world, sometimes physically. Well, in this case, when we're talking about the character's inner arc, we're talking about them going into a new world metaphorically, or in a new world in their life, a new stage of their life. So what we're typically going to do, which makes this inciting incident the most impactful event, is we're going to disrupt the character's emptiness. So let's look at a few examples of that, what that means. So if a character has a ghost event, something from the past that's haunting them, we may want to remind the character of that ghost, bring that ghost back. That's the case in Casablanca with Rick, where Ilsa comes back into a saloon. We might also force the character to confront the pain of the past. And that's the case in both Good Will Hunting and also in The Silence of the Lambs, where Clarice kind of has to go through therapy with Hannibal Lecter in order to catch the serial killer, right? Now, if the character has an obsession, we can have our inciting incident be the moment that threatens their obsession or removes it. We see this in Toy Story, where we're threatening Woody's position as top toy. In The Incredibles, Mr. Incredible, we take away his position as the hero. We can also offer an opportunity to pursue something that they've always wanted. So in The Little Mermaid, for instance, we're giving an opportunity for Ariel to pursue being a part of the human world. So a couple of examples, which I already mentioned briefly, but in Casablanca, Ilsa comes back to Rick, and that's this ghost from the past. Remember, he's got this emotional damage from being rejected, essentially, in Paris. And so Ilsa is the physical embodiment and reminder of that event, obviously. So the way that we start his character arc is by bringing back that ghost and forcing him to confront it. Same in Good Will Hunting. Will needs to undergo therapy in order to defer prosecution as part of an agreement. And so that's going to force him to confront his ghost experiences, the pain from his past. In Finding Nemo, we take away the thing that Marlin loves most, which is Nemo. In Toy Story, we threaten Woody's position as the top toy by bringing in Buzz. And so these inciting incidents, these are kind of the first major events, the first major event in the story that kicks off the story's chain of cause and effect. So the next step in this story structure is where the character needs to respond to that problem or that opportunity of the inciting incident. It's where they first start to take action, and this is where their plan typically becomes concrete. How are they going to respond to that big event that started to shake up their life? And this gives rise to a dramatic question, which is, will the character attain their goal? Will they get what they want? And this is the end of Act 1. All right, let's look at a couple of examples. So in Toy Story, remember, Buzz has come into Woody's life and threatened his position as top toy. So how does Woody want to respond? He wants to get rid of Buzz. That's his plan, basically. Get rid of Buzz. In The Incredibles, Mr. Incredible had his position as a superhero taken away, so how does he want to respond? He wants to pursue that opportunity to become a superhero again. And in Finding Nemo, Marlin had Nemo taken away, right? So what's the plan? Go find Nemo. And that's the central question over the course of that story. Will Marlin find Nemo or not in time before Darla gets him? It's also worth mentioning that a character may hesitate in response to the inciting incident. They may not immediately come up with a plan, which is kind of the case in Toy Story, for instance, where Woody doesn't immediately lash out at Buzz. And sometimes we think of this as the refusal of the call in the hero's journey paradigm. We also see that in, you know, Lord of the Rings and in Star Wars. But it's also possible for the protagonist to immediately respond to the inciting incident. Marlin doesn't sit around and try to think about whether he should go after Nemo. He just goes after him, right? So that's really the case when there's a high stakes inciting incident that really threatens something of deep value to the character. So the next step in this structure is the new approach to life. The character has to grapple with an alternate approach to life. Now that they are in this sort of new world, either physically and or metaphorically, the character has to deal with some alternate character or some alternate community that is approaching life fundamentally differently. We're going to look at a couple of examples, obviously, but the character typically has to incorporate some element, and this other approach to life, we might think of it as the anti-theme or the end goal of the character thematically, the place that they need to get in their character arc. So in Finding Nemo, Marlin needs to change from being completely a controlling person to being willing to surrender. And Dory is the influence character. Dory is the one who approaches life in a way that can influence Marlin to change. In Collateral, Max doesn't really take life by the horns, and he really needs to learn to have initiative and go after what he wants. And the villain, the antagonist, Vincent, that's the influence character in that story. Max has to learn from the villain in order to integrate that ability to have initiative and go after what one wants. And that's a big part of Collateral. In the movie Up, Carl needs to learn that he needs to stop holding on to only the past. He needs to learn to have new adventures and form new relationships. And Russell is the influence character in that story. And Carl needs to learn that relationships in the present are important for honoring the past and moving forward. All right, the next step in our story structure is the midpoint. It's also sometimes called the moment of first truth. This is where a character gets a hint at what life could be like if they embraced the theme or that alternate approach to life and healed their moral weakness. And from the midpoint to the crisis point, the character is going to be grappling with two approaches to life. Their previous approach, which is all about their moral flaw and approaching life, trying to avoid pain or unhealthily fulfill some obsession, and this new approach, which is going to be about living life, recognizing one's own value, and not having that moral weakness. So let's look at a couple of examples. In Finding Nemo, Marlin begins to let go. He begins to play a game with Dory in the jellyfish fields. He starts to surrender, and he stops being so in control. And that gives us a preview of what life could be like for Marlin if he were to do that. Now, importantly, in these midpoints thematically, sometimes there's this pullback and the character retreats back into their old way of thinking, which we definitely find in Finding Nemo after Dory gets stung by a jellyfish. In Up, Carl has this really nice scene with Russell. He starts to form a sincere father-son relationship with Russell when they're talking about Russell's wilderness badge and his father. And there's this really great connection between Carl and Russell. And we start to see what Carl's life could be like if he were to form new relationships going forward and not just hold on to the past. In Onward, Ian begins to trust himself while he's walking across this abyss, this chasm, and he's doing it with his own trust. He doesn't have this rope around him anymore, keeping him safe. So that's an important part of seeing what life could be like for Ian if he were to get rid of his moral weakness of kind of not trusting himself. And there are a couple of other things with him as well. So the next step in the structure is the crisis and the self-revelation. This is where a character is faced with an apparent failure or a Pyrrhic victory. So we sometimes know this as the all is lost moment, where everything seems like it's totally lost for the character and there's no way they can make it back from this. But there's also a Pyrrhic victory where a character could actually get what they want and realize that it's not worth it. It wasn't worth the price paid. And we kind of see that in Up with Carl when he actually does make it to Paradise Falls, but it just wasn't worth it. It didn't bring him happiness. So the character has to decide which side of the thematic dilemma they're going to choose. Are they going to hold on to their moral weakness, or are they going to change and adopt a healthy approach to life and adopt the moral approach that the influence character embodies, that different approach to life? So in a positive character arc, the character realizes that they were the source of their problems and not anybody else typically, or they'll realize that where they were blaming themselves in the past, it's actually someone else's fault for their ghost event, or no one's fault at all for their ghost event. So they don't need to blame themselves. And that's the case in Good Will Hunting with Will. So let's look at a couple of examples. In Toy Story, Woody realizes that he needs to share Andy's love. So that crisis moment is where Woody and Buzz are stuck in Sid's, and it looks like they're never going to be able to escape. And at the lowest point, that's where Woody is able to have a realization about his position and his moral weakness. He needs to realize that he needs to share Andy's love and not be selfish when it comes to him. In Up, that sort of all is lost moment is actually a Pyrrhic victory where Carl accomplishes his goal. He gets to Paradise Falls. He wins, but he realizes that that is not what's going to bring him happiness. And he needs to instead have new adventures and form new relationships. That's his self-revelation. In Finding Nemo, Marlin realizes he's in the whale with Dory. And it seems like they're going to die, but he realizes he needs to just let go and trust others. And he has that self-revelation, which he's later going to show through action with Nemo. And we'll look at that because that brings us to our next structure point, which is the climax of the story. This is the great decision moment. So this is where the character has had that self-revelation about what they need to do in order to live a better life. But now they need to make an important decision and demonstrate that they've learned their lesson through change. So this is the climax of the story externally and internally. We're going to find out whether the character gets the thing that they've wanted since the end of Act 1. And we're also going to find out if the character is able to change, if they're able to adopt this new approach to life. It's also worth mentioning that the crisis moment and the self-revelation, which I mentioned just briefly before, is the end of Act 2. So the climax is in the middle of Act 3. So the climax, let's look at some examples. Marlin in Finding Nemo has to decide whether to let Nemo risk his life to rescue Dory. And this is really a tough decision because if he lets Nemo go, he's potentially letting his son die and he's potentially giving up the one thing that he defines himself by. But now he has to demonstrate that he's able to surrender and let others live their own life. He's able to let Nemo be independent. That's a huge step for him, and that's why it's the climax of the story. In Casablanca, Rick has to decide whether to let Ilsa go with Laszlo on the plane and escape Casablanca without Rick. This will help protect the Allied cause in World War II, or he can take Ilsa for himself and potentially damage the cause because Laszlo won't have the love of his life, right? And so Rick has to make this tough decision. Is it love or is it duty? Do I take Ilsa for myself or do I protect the Allied cause? That's a tough decision. In The Lord of the Rings, Frodo has to decide whether to destroy the ring, which is essentially this decision between do we allow power in the hands of the few or should power belong to the hands of the many? Should we not concentrate so much power so that it may be used immorally, for instance? So Frodo has this tough decision before him. Should he take the ring for himself or should he destroy it in the fires? And interestingly enough, he actually makes the wrong choice, which is pretty interesting. So it's important to realize too that the character doesn't have to make the correct decision here. It can make for an interesting ending if they don't too. But you're also sending a particular message if they don't. And in the case of Lord of the Rings, spoiler alert, the ring does eventually get destroyed. So the resolution of the story, this is where the character lives in harmony with the story's theme. They have demonstrated that they've changed. They've demonstrated that their moral weakness is no longer present. This is in the case of the positive character arc. And in the resolution, the character may want to celebrate their victory with their loved ones. Or if it's a defeat, they may want to mourn with their loved ones. We typically want to see the character spending time with the other characters in the story. It tends to make for a cathartic ending. So in Toy Story, Woody shares Andy with Buzz, and they're at Christmas, and they're, you know, kind of mutually worried about having a new puppy. A pretty great moment at the end. In Finding Nemo, Marlin lets Nemo go off to school on his own, and this is kind of one last demonstration that Marlin has changed, and he's letting Nemo live an independent life, even if Marlin is still a little bit hesitant to do that. In Good Will Hunting, Will lets Skyler into his life. He kind of drops those emotional barriers and he runs off with her. And we're happy about that because that, again, also shows us that he has changed. He has dropped that armor that he has that's trying to keep others out. And he's finally learned to move on from his ghost. So that's a huge thing. So what have we learned with this structure and character arc? We've learned about how structure is not just an external journey, it's also an internal journey of the character changing over the story. And in a positive character arc, we learn that the character has to address their emptiness, their void, and overcome some moral weakness. And the inner journey is about a battle between two ways of approaching life. And over the course of the story, the character typically needs to confront that alternate approach to life and learn to adopt elements of it. And then they need to have a self-revelation about how that's the best way to approach life. And then in a climactic moment, they need to demonstrate that that's their new approach to life. This is for the positive character arc. So if you've enjoyed these tips, you know, I highly encourage you to check out more. We do daily writing tips every single day on kiingo.com, K-I-I-N-G-O. We also do it on Twitter and Instagram at Kiingo Creative, K-I-I-N-G-O Creative. Definitely check it out. And you can check out kiingo.com too. We have some courses, some other lessons, some other videos. We're really trying to create more resources for storytellers. And if you could really help us send those resources to more storytellers and help us reach more writers by liking, subscribing, leave a comment. Let me know what you want to see. What kind of storytelling lessons do you want us to go over? What kind of videos do you want us to create in the future? It really helps get these lessons out to more storytellers. And if you want to get especially involved, check us out on Patreon. Big thanks to all of our patrons. It helps so much. Check us out at patreon.com /Kiingo, K-I-I-N-G-O. Thank you so much. And until we see you next time, happy writing.